Hello guys, I hope you're fine. Again, we are here to talk environmental biotechnology and environmental microbiology in public health. And we are talking about biotechnology and the environment, that which type of biological techniques we can use in environment for its improvement and safety and for its betterment. We have talked in various aspects and various techniques. And we are talking here again. Soil cleanup sites and strategies. It was clear that whatever, which type of bioremediation activity or strategy will be adopted, it depends on the contaminated site or cleanup site. That which type of soil, which type of environment has been contaminated pollutants, and which type of strategy can be adopted, because every type of strategy cannot be adopted in every ecological system. Every ecological system and every site have specific strategies for its cleanup. Soil cleanups, either remove it ex situ bioremediation. Suppose there is a place where pollution has occurred, where spill has been. So either we have to remove that soil and we have to move it towards a site where we can remediate it, where we can treat it. That is called ex situ bioremediation, means we have to transfer that polluted soil from site to treatment site, from site to another place where we can treat it. Or in situ means in place where accident happened, where soil pollution occurred, we have to treat that soil over there in place. If aerobic may require bioventing, suppose if we need, the strategy is aerobic, so may require bioventing, we have to provide oxygen for the enrichment of the microbial population, most effective in sandy soil, because in bioventing we are giving air through pressure to the soil. Due to this, one, microbial population is flourishing over there, and the second thing, the concentration of pollutant is decreasing due to dissemination, and it is a volatile molecule and volatile fraction are going to the air. And such type of technique is mostly suitable in sandy soil. Removed salary phase, solid phase, composting, landfill, and biofuels. These things can be removed. If there is a salary phase, we can remove it. If pollutant is present in solid phase, we can remove it. If it is composting, we can remove it. We can dump into the landfill sites as well as in form of biofuels. Bioremediation of water, wastewater treatment. We have studied this site, technique in detail in our previous class. Just here we have to see that which type of strategy we can adopt for the type of cleanup. Here we have to treat, here we have to clean the wastewater. So strategy we are adopting over there, that it is consist on three phases: primary treatment, secondary treatment, as well as tertiary treatment. Primary treatment is physical, in which we are removing solid and suspended particles, and the remaining small particles we are trying to settle down in the bottom, and surface clean water we are shifting for biological treatment, either that is aeration tank or activated sludge tank, where active microbial population and air, aerobic and anaerobic microbial populations in presence of air, decomposing all organic material into elemental form. And all the concentration of elements are small particles are sieved, that is going to settle down, and liquid portion, mostly clean water, is going to another tank where that is free from all type of organic material and the remaining atomic material from these two chambers has been settled down, which has been transferred to anaerobic sludge digester. Sorry for inconvenience. So again, we are talking about that the remaining portions from aerating tank as well as from activated sludge tank, the remaining organic material is allowed to settle down and transferred to anaerobic sludge digester, where anaerobic sludge digester primary sludge is also coming from the primary settling tank, and from these two tanks where microbial decomposition taking place, the remaining organic material comes to the anaerobic sludge digester, where it is anaerobically decomposed and converted it into elemental form, which is further it is dried and used for as a fertilizer for the agricultural lands, landfill sites, and many more. And the water which is coming from these two area activated sludge system tank as well as from aerating tank, it is collected in one tank where chemical treatment is given to kill the remaining microorganisms over there. Mostly people are adding chlorine, but due to some problems, medical problems of chlorine, other techniques such as ozone and radiation, other techniques are used, and then this water can be reused or can be sent to the environment for as discharge. So this is clean up side. So here we want to explain only one thing, that we are adopting the remediating activity according to the clean up side and the substance, because here was sewage water, therefore we have adopted this type of clean up activity. So here if you will see bioremediation of water, groundwater cleanup, suppose if there is contamination in inside of the soil, inside oil tanks, petrol pump tanks, and chemical underground storage, due to any leakage, that chemical is going to seep inside of the soil and getting access to the ground aquifers, where it contaminating the groundwater, and at use this contaminant, this pollutant can come into the human contact by use, by drinking, and by irrigation or any purpose. So how we can treat such type of pollutants in soil? So here is our strategy: clean water, oxygen, nutrients. What we are doing, we are digging a well and we are providing nutrients, oxygen, and other microorganisms to that pollutant, that microbial communities will adopt over their nutrients, will support for their survivability, and will they will increase their growth. And growing, increasing microbial population will act on contaminant and will reduce its concentration gradually. And simultaneously, we are adding oxygen. The oxygen concentration is oxidizing or reducing the breakdown components. So gradually, so due to this, what happens? This type of treatment is called in situ bioremediation, where we have provided different factors, such as we have provided oxygen, we have provided microbial communities, we have added microbial communities, and we have provided nutrients for the growth and the proliferation of the microorganisms over there. So growing microbial population will use these pollutants for their energy purpose and convert it into less harmful compounds or less toxic compounds, or will degrade it completely. So again, here we want to establish this phenomena that we are selecting is bioremediation strategy according to the site of treatment. So here was the underground contamination, and we have to remediate microbial toxic material inside of this soil where we have injected microbial communities, nutrients, oxygen, and accelerated bacteria to decompose that pollutant. So, environmental diagnostics, we have to diagnose. How we can diagnose that which type of pollution is there? A promising new area of research involves using living organism to detect and assess harmful level of toxic chemical. This is most new and interesting area of this research. That first we have to diagnose. So this is a promising area of the research involved. We are using living organisms to detect the pollution, pollutant, pollution type, pollution concentration in every type of ecological system or inside of the accident. So sometimes we can use fish over here, sometimes we can use protozoans, sometimes we can use bacterial strains. So this is a new and promising area. Dinoflagellates we also can use for the detection of the pollutant in environment. Transparent thorax and abdomen, it means it is clear, its environment is clear. When healthy, Daphnia are fed a sugar substrate, beta-galactoside attached to a fluorescent marker that metabolizes the sugar and fluorescence under UV light. Like this, when Daphnia are stressed by toxins, they don't have the enzymatic ability to digest the sugar. And therefore don't fluorescence under UV light. So this is the technique by which we can use living organisms, we can use microorganisms for the detection of pollutant and pollutant concentration in any environment. This is new area of research and very interesting and promising area of the science. Toxicity reduction involves adding chemicals to hazardous waste in order to diminish the toxicity. Toxicity reduction involves adding chemicals to hazardous substances or waste in order to finish the toxicity. For example, if the toxicity results from heavy metal, EDTA will be added to the waste and the effluent will be tested again to determine if that toxicity has been acceptably reduced. Because EDTA chelates binds to metals, thereby making them unavailable to harm organisms in a particular body of water. So this is the chemical approach in which we are using another chemical to reduce the toxicity of any particular pollutant. So example here we have used, if there is a pollution of the heavy metals, what strategy, chemical strategy can be applied? We have to use any chelating agent. Suppose they are talking here, they have added EDTA, which will chelate the heavy metals and will reduce its availability to the living organism, and it will reduce its toxicity. Sometimes applying genetically engineered strains to clean up the environment, so people and scientists, they are working on it. They are designing such microorganisms which can be used for specific sites and for specific pollutants. Suppose such microorganisms are developed and naturally either that can be isolated from environment or can be genetically engineered in laboratory to decompose it, to degrade that specific type of pollutant. Suppose petroleum eating bacteria, Canada, Security of Chandra, electric, heavy metal, bioaccumulators, we can use certain bacteria which can accumulate heavy metals in body. Bacteria sequester heavy and radioactive metals and can use sometimes we can use microorganism as biosensors such as Lux Chin. Environmental disasters, case studies in bioremediation. The Exxon Valdez oil spill. It was the huge oil spill of the Exxon company ship, which was carrying oil from one place to another place, and it was broken down in Alaska Ocean and destroyed a huge ecological system and living organism over there. In the end, the indigenous microbes did the best job. At last, it was observed that the existing microbial population in Exxon Valdez oil spill zone, they have digested the oil at that place. Similarly, oil fields of Kuwait poses a problem due to the environmental condition, and the microbial populations can be used for such purposes. Carriers in environmental biotechnology, biodegradation, wastewater treatment, plant, organic farming, these type of jobs can be done. If person is studying environmental biotechnology, he can work in wastewater treatment plant, municipal water treatment plant. He will be an expert in organic farming. He can work in bioremediation sector, environmental cleanup companies, labs, developing superbugs. He can work in a research lab where he can develop a superbug for the treatment of the oil spills and pollutants. Biocatalyst, plastics, degradable and recyclable products. So, person who studied biotechnology, environmental biotechnology can work over there, and other mining companies and oil companies also. So, environmental biotechnology is going to end up. If you have some queries, questions and some problems related to environmental biotechnology, you can communicate with me by any means, and you will find me answerable in every platform, either that is electronic direct or indirect communication. So have a nice time and good luck for final exams.